When you talk about persecution, a good thing, I love what they're saying, because it's all about not becoming bitter, and it's all about forgiving.
Yeah.
And I can say, I really experienced, we have been thrown out of two houses. One time there was a pastor, he felt God spoke to him that he should give us a house, and it was somehow our house, but we did not sign under the paper because I trust a brother. But then God said we should do something, and he did not like it. And suddenly he changed totally, and he threw us out of our house. We got lost $60,000.
Wow.
We bought another house at that time, but because of persecution, my wife Lena got sick. We went to a desert. It was really hard. I lost my job. She was laying in bed in a half year, and we lost all our friends. He sent an email out to everybody in our network and warned against us. It was hard. I cried a lot, we cried a lot, and it was hard. One of the things God revealed to me in that time was if we look at Jesus' life, Jesus had 12 apostles. He could have done without Peter, James, and John, but he could not do without Judas. Judas was the only apostle that was necessary in Jesus' life to take him to the cross. I can see those people who have caused most pain in my life have been the most important people to take me to the cross, to make me die. Not except it's Joseph in the Bible. Joseph got a dream, but he was proud and God needed to humble him, and a lot of things need to happen before. So his brothers throw him in the pit. And we know what pit stands for, preachers ain't training. It was his brothers who threw him in the pit. Reuben, he felt like, hey, he wanted to help Joseph up. But we are thankful that he did not do it, because we know the whole story. Now when we experience persecution, we don't know the whole story, but God knows the whole story. And it had been necessary. And like Joseph was thrown in the pit, that church who threw me in the pit, that pastor who took our money, who cheated us, who caused my wife was sick, who caused we lost our house, who caused I wanted to die, that same pastor, that same leadership that came to the Jesus Hotel a few months ago, looked around and said, whoa, this is what you get when you are faithful with God, the calling God had given you. But that time when I was faithful, they threw me out. Then they invited me to their church to speak. That church, I have like, I in the beginning to God, I hated. I hated everything with it. It was so hard. I need to use so much energy of praying and keeping my heart pure, because we have got hurt so much again and again and again. But now they invited me to speak. But when I came there to speak, I did not like, ha ha, look at me, I was right, you are wrong. I did not do that. Because if I did that, I have learned nothing. I came instead and said, come on friends, we know each other. We know what had happened. I just want to say thank you. We have learned so much. And we have. So we have to turn it around. See that, like, remember, Jesus could not do without Judas. Those people who cause us most pain is the most necessary in our life, because it's all about taking us to the cross. All about us dying. But if you want persecution to stop, I can also give you a simple tools and you stop right away. Remember this. Just do one thing and everything's going to be good. Compromise. Just compromise, everything's going to be good now and worse later. And I say that often there is a wall, the church wall, the system, it cannot handle the new wine. It's going to break. You don't see the system, you don't see the wall before you start to act. Maybe off, it's good, you can do it, come on, we love it, go out, pray for people, just do it. But what then? Then you start to baptize people. And maybe people who came and was related to the church and suddenly, hey, I was the pastor, I was supposed to baptize him. And then you start to feel the wall. I just want to say, God, he leads us. Pray. Don't look at Jesus. He never answered bad. He never opened his mouth. He just received. Do that. My book, The Last Reformation, it took me 3 years after I left it before I was able to write it. Why? Because I was bitter. I was hurt. I dealt with it. But it took time to really, before God said, now you can do it. Otherwise, I'm going to come with a bitter root. We don't want that. I don't know what you're going to go through, but just remember those things. And then understand, love, forgive, and be thankful. And then let the Holy Spirit take you step by step. And he will lead you, and it's different where you had to go. But let's say we are not the one who's going to give up, no matter what persecution is going to come. So we are not ground number two. Now there is only one thing left. If you do not fall in this ground, if you are not ground number three, you are the good ground and bear a lot of fruit. But it's interesting, if I say to the church today, I say to us today, there's only one thing we really need to be careful of. One thing. People will often think of big sins, homosexuality and other sins. But that one thing is not that. The one thing I've seen had killed most people's life is a new house. It is. A house, a job, new car. Because ground number three is those people who are deceived. Deceitfulness of riches. Longing for other things and worries. How often have we not seen young people on fire? I want to be a missionary. I want to serve Jesus. They're on fire. And then the parents or somebody say, yes, do it. But you need an education first. You need something to fall back on. And then what do they do? They take an education. Take a job. Continue. Grow up in it. More position. Job. Many years after, they're standing with a good paycheck and a good education, and the fire and the dream is gone. We've seen it so many times. Or seen people who are on fire, they want to serve God, they get married, they still want to serve God, we want to serve God. Oh, look at that house. Oh, it's so beautiful. We still want to serve God, but we need a house. Beautiful house, but the kitchen is old. Okay, we just changed the kitchen. We live a simple life, we just changed the kitchen. Now we have a new kitchen, but not the rest of the house will go old. And suddenly you are spending time and time and time and time fixing up, doing it, and you are deceived. Because you don't have time. Time to do the kingdom work. And I know what I'm talking about because a few years ago we were ground number three. I've been working like full time doing ministry like 18 years now, almost 15, 17 years, moving and doing church planning and working. But we became a little older. And our friends, they got a house and they had some money and free value and we were living a simple life. And then in the end, I want a house. And you know what? One day the bank called and said, you can get your own house. And I was like, yes. I still remember when I got my house. I was so happy. I still had cried instead. Because what happened? I found it fall in that ground. Because we got the house, old house, the kitchen was old. So I fixed up the kitchen. The bathroom was old. I fixed up the bathroom. Suddenly, 1.5 year was gone. Just fixing up. And when I fixed the house, it was like every corner was like. Nice house. value do you have?
None.
Well, what happened? I was already deceived because I said I had a house, and that was a lie. The bank have a house. And I was now a slave to the bank. So I need to pay the mortgage. So I need to work a lot. And I have some extra job. I work like 48 hours shift and work. And I work and I earn a lot of money and I had my big house and my big car and I came home from work and I was tired. My wife one time said, "Torben, come on, there's more than sitting seeing TV." But I'm tired, I've been working a lot, I'm tired, I just want to. And time just went. And suddenly, 1 year, 1.5 years, 2 years, you're like, and where was the fruit? Because our biggest problem for many of us is that we don't have time. And this is your challenge when you come home from here. Now it's weekend, but you're going to come home and Monday is going to come. And a new week. And we have our kids and we have our house and we have our job and we have our hobbies and we have our friends. And we don't have time to do the work in the kingdom. But the truth is that everybody have time. Everybody has 24 hours. It's just not everybody who have the right focus and spend the time the right way. So I was happy that God one day stopped us. Because I was happy when I got my job, you know, when I got my house, and then some time later the telephone called and I was fired. And there I cried. I should have rejoiced instead. Because suddenly I got fired and suddenly I could not pay the bills. And what do you do when you are fired and cannot pay the bills? No, you, God help me! Where are you? And I start to pray and I start to pray because I needed God. If God is not coming, I have a problem. Because my wife was sick at that time, we went through a really desert period. I could not get a new job because I need to take care of her. And we did not have the money and we did not have anything. And I was standing there, God, I need you now. I'm talking like it was fun, but it was not fun. I was crying a lot and it was terrible. But out there in the desert, out there God woke us up. And one day, I got a little money so I could pay for some of the bills. So I'm like, okay, now we are good for 1.5-2 months. And then I said, okay, now I'm going to fast. So I decided going to fast 40 days one more time. So I took a 40 days fast to see God. And it was like God was far away. I've not heard his voice for a long time. Then the last day in the fast, the 39th day, he spoke to me again. I discovered it had been a long time. When have I last heard you really speak to me? I don't know about you, but I cannot just go into a room and close my door 5 minutes and then hear him speak. It takes time to renew the mind and focus on him. And there he spoke to me. I heard him say, go to this city. And he said I should go to another city in Denmark. I went to that city, there I met a guy who got healed in the knee, and he said afterwards in shock, whoa, when did God speak to you about coming to my city? And I said, first afternoon at 3 o'clock, why? Because I've been praying to God the last 3 days, sent Tom so he could pray for me so I could get healed. So I saw that he was the answer. He had been praying, God sent me there, and I came and I also answered for his prayer. Because he needed operation the next day and he could cancel. So what happened? When we came home from that trip, something had happened in us. What had happened in us? We had tasted something. taste the real stuff. There is nothing like being led of the Holy Spirit. There is nothing like being exactly where God wants you to be. And I think some of you have tasted something the last days. And I had like, hey, I want more. We have tasted something. I want more. This is real. I want it. So what happened? We came home to our ground number three. But because something had now changed in us, and if it took me 39 days to hear God speak to get that experience, okay, I need to make a life where I can see God and do His will, because I want more of this. So the first thing we came when we came home to our ground number three was, I need more time for God. So the first thing was we throw the hill machine out of the house, or the TV out of the house, call it what you want. And suddenly the TV was out of the house, so I was sitting like this. And now I didn't have TV anymore, but then what? Then I could do other things. I could read my Bible, I could pray. And it gave us a little more. And it gave us more experience with God, so we said, we want more. And one of the things, we are really stressful in our house, because like we have a boy and two girls, and the girls were small at that time. And one of our Simona's room, it was pink. There were so many pink things, pink toys. And there were so many things. So every time I enter her room, I was so stressful because there were so many things. And if I should clean her room, Lene, help me! Because I did not know where to start and end. And it always stressed us. So what did we do? We took a big bag. We took the toy and said, what do you want to keep this? Both. No.
This
or
this?
This.
How about this?
And we just emptied her room and threw a lot of things out. When we throw a lot of things out in the room, I discovered two things. The first thing I discovered, there was a flaw. But also, I just thought that it was good because since that day, they had cleaned their own room. Because they know, well, this is going there, this is going there, this is going there. So we did not need to clean their room anymore. It gave more time. So we started to empty out. Five trailers, out with it. Everything, things we do not need, out with it. And we have so many things, like we got married 20 years ago. That time was 15 years ago. We still have a robe we got 15 years ago. We have been moving 10 times, and it's still been following us, and we've not used it one time. Out with it, out with it, out with it. And the more we got rid of in our life, the more time we got, the more focus we got on God, there's less things to disturb us. And the more we start to see, we start to see stronger things, how the Holy Spirit led us. We start to see more fruit. And one day my wife woke up, let's get rid of the house. And we were just ready for us. And we got rid of the house. And then we moved from our big house to a small apartment. And it was in the same city, only 500 meters, but it was like coming to another country. Our neighbor was a mosque, and people were shooting each other, and we were the only happy married family with kids there. But it was cheap. And I remember that when we moved there, I remember we lay on the sofa one day, as soon as we moved in, and I was laying on the sofa, and Lane was laying there. I remember so clear. I looked at her. This is weird. I have a feeling now I've not had for a long, long time. What to do? Come on, it's clean all over the place. There's nothing to paint. There's no garden to clean. There's nothing to do. What to do? Okay, I go out praying. Because we got rid of all of that. And then we had more time seeing them. And God started to move us again, and He moved us a new place, and we started to go on mission, and we started to see how God was working. One time, God moved, and we moved in a small basement, like this corner here. And I remember when we moved into that basement, inside I was crying. I was really crying. I don't want to live in this small basement. What would people not say? We had three kids. But when we came in that small, small basement, before when I had the house, I needed to pay like $3,000 per month for everything. For the house and car. But now, we are living for $500 or $300 per month. So we needed to only work a few days. And we have another time to see God and doing His will. And down there in the basement, because we took the time to seek Him, God spoke to us. And one day He said, start a pioneer school. And He was there where He started to grow. Down, 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 and then up, up, up. And we understood what the Bible is saying about seek first the kingdom of God and do His will. And then and other things would be added to you. We are deceived because we often think we are blessed. But to be honest, if what we have is a blessing for God, why do our non-Christian neighbor have the same thing? Because they are working as hard as you are working. And I discovered something there, because I don't believe in the prosperity teaching where do. But the Bible still says that God will take care of our needs.
Amen.
But we had to focus first on the kingdom of God and first do His will, and then we'll be added to us. We start with all the things first. And what was interesting, we have been living a simple, simple life doing the will of God. When I ended up the pioneer school, as many of you have seen, the last thing I said in the 20 lesson is, we are moving to a new city. Because in the end of the pioneer school, we had like, we need more room. What now? We cannot continue filming in the basement, doing what we do. We need more room and we need people to work with us. But we were alone in that city. We had no friends. We did not know anybody in that city, because we moved to a new city. We thought we were going to start a church, but then we did the pioneer school and we were busy with that. So we did not know anybody. And I said, God, what shall we do? We cried to God, and then I heard Him speak. Move to Aalborg. It's another city in Denmark. Aalborg. We are moving to Aalborg. And look, my wife, we are moving to Aalborg. And I was so excited and went to a website and we could rent a big house there. And we could not find a house in our city, and we know it was gone. The only problem was it cost $20,000 just to take over the house. And I had never had $20,000 my whole life. But we knew it was gone. I went to bed that night. Aalborg. Here we are. I woke up. We are moving to Aalborg. We are moving to Aalborg. When I woke up the day after, I checked my telephone, and what is happening there? Because of my bank account, there was a lot of numbers. And somebody I've never met had just put $20,000 in our bank account.
Wow.
So I jumped in the car, let's go to that city. We came to that city, and there, that guy who had given us the money, he was living near that city. I contacted him. I said, hi, who are you? And then he was a famous football player in Denmark, former famous football player who had got saved through our ministry some years before. And he said, God just spoke to me yesterday that I should give you $20,000. He said, I love you already. I said, well, we are going to work together, because God had just spoke to me about moving to this city. And he was living outside the city. He said, interesting, God also just spoke to me about moving to this city. And what is more interesting, before our desert period, I got a prophecy. One time we left the church and our friends crawled out. It was really hard. I got a clear prophecy where God said, I don't care who walked away from you. There is somebody who has meant so much in your life. But you have to know that this division is from God. And God has let you to go to a desert for you to learn to be dependent on God and other people. But now your pain is over and God is going to take you from the dust up to the mountaintop. And there is a very rich businessman in your country who is going to support you. And when everybody hear that, they are going to be surprised. I got that word 8 years before, I think it was. 8 years later, that very famous former football player, he supported us. And now we don't have a basement anymore. Now we have a hotel and four houses. We have 70 beds where people can come and get trained. We don't know anything. It's not us in your base. But God has taken care of our needs. Where the Holy Spirit wants to be part of our life. Where, don't buy a house, don't buy a car, don't take a job, don't do anything before you ask Jesus. Yeah, is this your will? For example, the famous football player, he came to me a short time ago, last year, he came to me and said, Tom, I just feel God is saying to me that I should give you a car, you can drive it. So here is $30,000, and you can go out and buy a car, go out and find a car for $30,000, I'm going to buy it, and you can rent it really cheap for me. And this is really cheap, really cheap. So suddenly I had $30,000 to go out to buy a car. Ah, I never had a car. My oldest car always been like 15 years old. And like, whoa, okay. So I was like, what car? And I remember I said to Lynn, let's look at the car. And we had to find a car that day. He wanted to find a car. So we went out to look at Peugeot. It's a French car, you know. You don't know. You have different cars here. And we went out to look at a Peugeot. And I remember I was looking at Peugeot. It was like a beautiful car. And I looked at it. It was like, they're like, oh, I like that car, it's a cool car, I really wanted that car. But at the same time, I felt like, no, God, I don't want to drive in something that can offend people. I even had a problem with the Chrysler we had rented here. I wanted to get it back because I don't want to have something if it offend people. But I said, okay, God, shall I have this car, shall I not? Oh, God, I don't know, what car do you want me to have? And then I felt God said to me, go to a wedding. There was a wedding in that city that day with somebody I only met. I said, God, I cannot go to a wedding. I don't have time for that. I have to find a car and have guests coming in this afternoon to meet me. Go to a wedding. I said to my wife, Lena, I have to go to a wedding. So I know it's a bad time. We have guests coming this afternoon. I have to find a car. But just feel God say I have to go to that wedding. So I take a shower and took nice clothes on and jump in my own car to went to the wedding. And on the way to the wedding, I said, God, I don't have time to go to a wedding. What do you want me to do to that wedding? Shall I give a word, a knowledge? What shall I do, God? I don't know so good. And God, I need to find a car today. What car shall I have? And then I came to the wedding and it was a little awkward because I did not know them so good. Like, why am I here? But after the wedding, after I got married, I sat down and talked with an older couple. And we started to, I had seen him some years before, and we started to talk about the Holy Spirit and how the Holy Spirit is leading. And while I was talking with him, somebody came and said, knocked him on the shoulder and said, hey, are you ready to drive in 10 minutes? I said, yeah, I'm ready to drive. And I looked at him, drive? What do you mean? Yeah, I'm the driver, I'm going to drive the wedding couple. There is like a tradition then when you get married, you drive in a nice car out to get pictures and so on. So I said, oh, so you are the one who's going to ride the wedding couple. Yeah, I am. Oh, then you have a nice car since I asked you. And then he said, yes, and he looked at me. Yes, and young man, if you are ever going to buy a new car, you have to buy a Toyota Avensis. And he did like that, point in my face. Like, what? Actually, I have to buy a new car today. I don't know what car. Can we go and look at your car, what it is? Yeah, come out. So we went out looking at his car, and we were standing there looking at the car, and I was thinking, okay, it's a nice car. But I really like the Peugeot also. And I was saying this, and then that man looked at me. Young man, this is the best car I ever had. It was not like the Peugeot I had before I broke down all the time. You never buy a Peugeot, you have to buy a Toyota Avensis. And he looked at me and said that, and I was like, Holy Spirit, are you really talking to me right now? And then he looked at me the third time. So young man, just listen to the Holy Spirit. This is the car you need to buy. And then I drive on to Yosama. But the Holy Spirit wants to be part of our everyday life. When we talk about what house, when we talk about what job, when we talk about what car, Jesus wants to own us. He has everything. And I think what we need to do often, we need to step down of the ladder. Amen. Because what we think is our blessing truly is our curse. And most here is ground number three. When you come home now, you said, I want it, but you have to change things around you. Because right now you don't have time. Have fun with me? And people, what about worries? Worries is another thing. People ask, what about the kids? I remember when we moved in that basement, I was crying inside because other couples, other people, they were living a nice life. Our friends, they came in church, and they were doing things we don't have money for, and they were really doing fine. And people looked at us like, what about the kids, Tom? Because our kids did not even have their own room at that time. It was just a curtain, and they're living in a hall. It was hard. But I reminded myself, we are doing this for the kids. Because if there is something our kids do not need, is seeing people who are living a normal life and coming to church 2 hours every Sunday. Yeah. And you can see our son now, 17 years old, he knows how to cast out demon, heal the sick, and do everything. And he loves it. And I'm a proud father because he said to me, Father, I will not take an education. Yes! I want to be a missionary like you. Sit down, go with me. Why? Because, come on, this is life. We need to live a life where we are dependent on God in everything. But I want to just encourage you. We bear fruit now. We do. What we are doing now, we've only done 3 years like this. When I came first time to America 3 years ago, do you know how many came to our meeting?
How many?
Six. Wow. First time we came to America 3 years ago, there came six people to our meeting. But do you know what the Holy Spirit knows what he's doing? Because we were doing a meeting, I came down, we were at a hotel, we came down. Six people. Hi. Okay. Let's start. We are faithful in the small things. So I start to teach them. But as soon as I start teaching, somebody knocked the door. And somebody came in the room and said, what are you doing in our room? We have rented this room. What? No, we have rented this room. 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 So we went out to the reception and said, hey, let's say they rented the room, but we have rented the room. And the reception lady saw, oh, I did a double booking. And then the man who was there said, but what now? We are going to have a prayer meeting. And we looked at, what? We are going to talk about discipleship. What? Yes, we are. Can we join you? Yes, you can. And then there came 30 more people in. And suddenly we were 36 instead of. And God just came. And then when we need to go out and kickstart, those 30 people, they are just ready to do it. So we went out and trained and kickstarted them. And then the pastor in that church, he was like, I want it. I want more. Can you come and speak in my church on Sunday? And I said, actually, I have another invitation, but yeah, sorry for that. But the day after, the other invitation, they canceled it. They didn't want me anymore. So I just said, I can come to your church. And that church, it was where I saw the paralyzed woman got healed, first time I saw that. Then we are going to New York, but we have to hurry home because we have another invitation with a small group, and they also canceled it. So we have two invitations, both canceled, but God had his own idea. Because that day in New York, we say, okay, we have the whole day, we don't have any meeting, let's just stay in New York. And there we did the New York video many of you have seen, and 200,000 have seen that video now. So it's better than 30 people at home. Yeah. Amen. So we just 30 people. And now there have been over 500 those two times. But it had cost a price. The question is, are we willing to pay that price? So if we look at this, most of you are ground number two or three, I think. Most is going to come home and you're going to experience persecution and you're going to compromise because of that. almost, or you, many of you is ground number three. You're going to come home, you will, you will, you want this, but you're not ready to pay that price. If you look at Jesus' disciple, he met a guy who was sitting down and said, come and follow me, and he left everything behind and followed Jesus. Matthew. We met another guy, the rich young ruler. He said the same thing. Give everything away and come and follow me. And he went sad away. Why? Because his love of money. He was ground number three. This is a message to encourage you. You can decide what you want to be. Look at us. It's only five years ago, we were ground number three. But we decided we wanted, no matter what it shall cost. I don't know what it's going to cost in your life. Some of you maybe need to stop
your job.
Some of you maybe need to take one day off every week and start to do ministry. Some of you maybe need to get rid of some friends. Some of you need to get rid of your hobby. But I love playing golf, and so what? Some of you have to get rid of the TV. Some of you have to get rid of the house. I don't know what it is. Go home, look at your life, and say, what do we need to change to be the good one? Lene, you come up and play. So Lene is going to sing a song. I want you to just look at those stamps, look at those four numbers. And then think, what are we? What am I? And when we end up this meeting later, I would like you to, we will pray for people later if you want prayer, but it's not always praying. So I say, if you have got prayed for, then a good thing you could do is go away, go home and just spend some time with God, if you're married. Go home, look each other in the eyes, and look at your life, and say, what do we want? But I can say the truth is that nobody, just before they're going to die, nobody before they're going to die is going to look back at their life and say, why did I not have some more time on my work when I had the chance? Or why did I not get a bigger TV? Or why did I not get that big car I really wanted? Nobody's going to say that. But many people before they're going to die is going to look back and say, why did I not do something crazy for Jesus? Why did I not give up everything? Why did I keep back? Why did I think more about people around me? What people expect of me? Instead of what God wanted. I want to end up with last thing. Michael from Australia, who's one of the leaders in Australia now, where it's really growing. His story you can see on our YouTube channel. God spoke to him one day. God started to work him, and God spoke to him one day and said, he just bought a new car, and God said, give away your car. I love that car. But then one night, God gave him a dream. In the dream, he was standing 10 years in the future with the car keys in his hands. And now it was not a new car anymore. Now it was an old car. And then in the dream, he looked back and saw all the things he had left out of because he was not willing to pay this price. And after he got that dream, he washed the car and gave it away. And then later God spoke to him that he should stop his job, and he did that. And then you think everything went like this, no, everything went like this. Now that this period is starting. The doubt, the fear, the unbelief, the battles, is Jesus really there? Do he take care of me? What about my needs? What about this? And it went down and down and down and down and down. And in the end, they stood out on the street with two suitcases and did not have any money. But right there out on the street without having any money, just serving and serving and serving Jesus, somebody kept running to him and gave him a slip with some money and said, here's money to rent a new house. But when they then rented the house, the man who owns the house house. He was not a believer, but he met God and he said, you can stay in my house, but I don't want your money. And now they've been living a half year with a big house and swimming pool without paying for it. The last thing he spilled, somebody came and gave him his credit card and his PIN code and said, if you ever need anything, just use mine. This is his story. When God is taking care of our needs. Luke chapter 10, don't worry, don't take extra purse, anything with you, because he's going to take care of our needs. We need to trust God in everything. But it's a journey. And I cannot say where you are on that journey, but let the Holy Spirit speak to you. I will pray and just listen to Lena's song. God, I thank you for this night. I thank you for what you're doing, God. I pray for everybody who's in this room right now. Holy Spirit, I pray that you will speak to them. You will show them what they need to do to become ground number four. Areas where they have compromised and they need to stop compromising. Areas where they have been deceived by riches and longing for other things that have no value. Areas where they have been deceived by worries. What about this? What about this? God, help them to trust you. Help them to seek your kingdom first and do your will first. Pray for Lena's song now that you're going to speak to people. You're going to show them what they need to change, what they need to do in their life to become ground number four. Speak to them, Holy Spirit, I ask you, in the name of Jesus.
Do you still remember the word? Spend time with me. I'm guiding you.
time is 9 o'clock. What we want to do is we want to end now. If you really want prayer and you're not coming tomorrow, you can come here and Sonny and my daughter-in-law is going to help pray for you. Otherwise, I want to give you an hour, give you some time, give it to Jesus. Come on, very often we end up and we talk and we forget things. I would like to empty this room very fast and not a lot of talking. Go home. Go to the hotel. Go for a walk. Just spend time with Him. Give some time with Him. Talk with Jesus. Go out and say, Jesus, I'm here. What am I? What do you want me to do? But it's all about, we have been talking about discipleship and doing a lot of things and we need to do it. But it really comes down to one thing, our relationship with Him. It really comes down to, do we know Him? Do we spend time with Him? And very often we hear a sermon and then we talk, a lot of things happen and we forget it. Can we do that? I know we're not used to that and I like that. So tomorrow we start at 10 o'clock and we're going to end up tomorrow. You can also buy books tomorrow, don't focus on that now, you don't have to focus. We can talk tomorrow, we are going to connect with each other tomorrow, we're going to focus on that tomorrow. I just want you to give Jesus some time. Go home, go for a walk, talk with Him. Are you married? Go home, look at each other's eyes. Talk about life, talk about where are we now? Where do we want to go? What is our dream? What have value? What have not value? What have God been speaking to us about? And then pray. Can we do that? Okay. See you tomorrow.